problems. So I was in Quito working with a workshop, and I heard that Santiago Vizcaíno had just won first prize from the Ministerio de Cultura in Ecuador, and this was just a few months after this book had come out. It's his first book. He worked on it between the ages of 22 and 24. I think it came out when he was 25 or 26. And I liked reading it, I liked the imagery, so we got together and spent a week working on it together. A week for me of great pleasure and for him of great agony, because, as he says, a poet likes to write poems, he doesn't like to analyze them. But when you're working with me, I force you to analyze it because I want to make sure I get it right. So that was the painful beginning. Doloroso, el trabajo para usted.
Divertido para mí.
Divertido para mí. And so we're now touring with this book, which just came out 2 weeks ago bilingually. All these poems have appeared in magazines in the United States before. Santiago now has a book of fiction, which I would have called Kill Your Mother, or To Kill Your Mother, but it's titled in English, Matricide. It's a collection of short stories. It was just published in Argentina, and it caught up with us on this tour, and so that's over there too. He has two other books coming out within the next month and a half. Un libro está ya impreso. ¿Cómo se llama esto?
Hábitat del camaleón.
Habitat. Oh, the habitat. The habitat of the chameleon. And he sent off the final proofread, electronic proofread version just a few days ago. And then in May, he will have another book coming out, which is.
Este es.
Oh, este.
Ajá.
Sí. Ajá. Pero tú tienes otro, es el libro sobre tu hijo.
Ah, pero es una plaqueta.
Ajá. He also has a child of 1 year old, and so he has a chapbook of poems about him. He has written and published an essay which won a big prize. It was called, it was a study of the poetry of Pizarnik, Alexandra Pizarnik, an Argentinian poet who ended up killing herself. The study has a really good name, Decir el Silencio. In fact, how would you translate that?
Say the silence.
I can think of six different titles for that book in English. I really like Decir el Silencio. It could be Say the Silence, Say Silence, Speak Silence. You could even say Tell Silence. All of those would be quite interesting and quite different from each other. In any case, he is interested not just in words as a poet, but in the silence and the emptiness around words, or perhaps not the emptiness, but the space around words. So I normally have been translating for the last 45 years from Brazilian and Portuguese, but 8 or 9 years ago, I started working with Ecuadorians, and this is my third book of Ecuadorian poetry, but my Spanish remains deficient, and so I have to work extremely hard with the poets. And they suffer a great deal, especially this one. So we're going to do a bilingual reading from this book, and we're happy to discuss anything you like afterwards. Okay, so Destruction in the Afternoon is actually Devastación en la Tarde. I toned down the title because in English we don't like hyperbole. And I think the word devastation has been overused. So I simply quieted it down to Destruction in the Afternoon. He was influenced by The Wasteland at the time he wrote it.
Yeah.
He was also influenced by surrealistic poetry, both the French and the Latin Americans. Octavio Paz, he was reading at the time. Cesar Vallejo. And,
sí, bueno,
había otro mexicano.
Sí, José Emilio Pacheco.
Pacheco. Ok.
Bueno, gracias por estar aquí.
Thanks for coming.
Por la invitación, es un lindo espacio.
It's a nice space, thanks for the invitation.
Y también es un espacio íntimo, precisamente propio para la poesía.
It's an intimate space which is appropriate for poetry.
Bueno, leeremos algunos poemas de este libro llamado Devastación en la tarde. Unos poemas cortos de la primera parte del libro que se llama Las manos en la tumba.
We're going to read some short poems from the first part of the book. The first part of the book is called Hands in the Grave.
Uno. ¿Tú quieres sentarte,
papá? Yeah. So forgive me, but I'm going to sit down. This is the first inroads of time. Ah, ¿tú también?
Claro.
Increíble. Inacreditable. Okay,
ya.
Ah.
Uno. ¿Quién anuncia con torpeza el fin del cierzo y su retorno? Del otro lado hay una herida con un grito, un enorme moscardón hambriento, un cadáver azulado que sonríe, un olor como de pasto tibio. ¿A dónde fueron a parar los incendiarios, los indelebles, los que agotaron su último llanto frente al ataúd del tiempo? Del otro lado queda una fosa de huesos secos, una mano que ansía un brazo, una barriga agusanada.
This is poem number one, from Hands in the Grave. Who announces with torpor the end of the north wind and its return? On the other side, there is a wound like a scream, an enormous hungry blowfly, a smiling bluish corpse, a smell like that of warm grass. Where do they find themselves, the incendiaries, the indelible, those who shed their final tears before the coffin of time? On the other side, a pit of dry bones remains, a hand that longs for an arm, a stomach full of worms.
Tres. Un ángel se pasea embriagado, huraño como un búho. Las mujeres estrujan sus senos y les brota una leche agria que dan de mamar a pequeños y sombríos esqueletos. Del otro lado, las arañas, sus patas, sus palpos lujuriosos. Escúchenme, dije, pero era como el verbo de una antigua patria torrencial.
Number three. An inebriated angel strolls by, shy as an owl. The women squeeze their breasts and a bitter milk comes forth, with which they suckle their little somber skeletons. On the other side, spiders, their feet, their lascivious palps. Listen to me, I said. But it was like a word from an ancient torrential homeland.
Ocho. ¿Acaso somos culpables de esta terrible mutación? Oímos nuestras propias voces como una endeble manifestación del fin. Nuestras manos, como dos cruces abandonadas, palpan la sombra. Y es horrible la distancia que media entre la cicatriz y la noche.
Number eight. Could we be guilty of this terrible mutation? We hear our voices like a feeble manifestation of the end. Our hands, like abandoned crosses, reach to touch the shadows. And terrible lies the distance between the scar and the night.
Once. Somos una horquilla en el pelo de Dios, un gallo mudo, un olivo aletargado. Quisiera poder decir de la tristeza, pero una horda de murciélagos cierran mi boca y se arrastran en la oscuridad de mi grito.
11. This presented a problem for the translator that the translator was unable to solve satisfactorily. Horquilla, Orquilla is a bobby pin, a hairpin. But the first line is, we're just a hairpin in God's hair. So you can't say hair twice. On the other hand, these are very serious, somber, devastating poems. I don't think you can talk about a bobby pin either. It's simply too light. It's like stories about teenagers at the country club prom in F. Scott Fitzgerald, a bobby pin. And so I said, we are just an ornament in God's hair, a silent rooster, a lethargic olive tree. How I wish that I could speak of sorrow, but a horde of bats seals my mouth, crawling through the darkness of my screen. But ornament perhaps is a little bit more elaborate than the minuscule. The orquilla is a small little thing, and that was what he wanted to emphasize, how small we are.
Not as specific either.
So, I don't know what I should have done.
I thought you said orquídea at first.
Orquídea?
Yeah.
No.
Well, that would be,
that would be interesting.
Yes.
No. Ese sería otro sentido al
poema. Otro sentido, sí. Sí.
Absoluto. Uh-huh. Otro perfume. Okay, go. Vamos.
12. Mi corazón es una cama donde copulan alacranes. No hay guarida alguna para este pálpito de fosa. ¿Hace cuánto el espectro no ha venido con su luz violeta? Oímos la mudez de la noche y olvidamos. Así se cierra el círculo.
Number 12. My heart is a bed of copulating scorpions. There is no hiding place from this throbbing in the grave. How long has it been since the ghost last appeared with its violet light? We listen to the muteness of the night, and we forget. Thus is the circle closed.
Quince. Ese muro ennegrecido de sudor y grito, esta tierra devastada donde el silencio muerde como diente de centauro. Aquí ansiamos la muerte, pero ella golpea mi muslo, mascuye en mi oído y se va como una asquerosa mosca.
15. This wall black with sweat and screams, this devastated earth where silence bites like a centaur's tooth. Here we yearn for death, but it strikes me on the thigh, mumbles something in my ear, and vanishes like a disgusting fly. For me, this poem is an echo of the story of Jacob wrestling with the angel of the Lord. And I think he is wrestling trying to get a name, trying to get a word. And the angel, he can never defeat the angel. And in the end, after a whole night of struggling, the angel strikes him on his thigh, but gives him a name. I think his name becomes Israel, is that right? And I've always felt, I didn't ask Santiago when we were working on this, but to me, this poem feels as if it is a continuation of the story, or a re-examination of the story of Jacob wrestling with the angel. Because we have strikes me on the thigh and mumbles something in my ear, and we don't know what it is that he learns.
No. 17. Y ofrezco mi pupila, mi pierna derecha, pero alejen de nosotros la memoria. Esta picadura en el vientre, este tatuaje. Yo puedo retardar la caída, la ceniza y el abismo. Mi carne tendrá seguramente un olor a campo, a resignación.
17. I offer the pupil of my eye, my right leg. But take from us our memories, that stinging in the gut, that damn tattoo. I could delay the fall, the ashes, the abyss. My flesh will surely have the smell of fields, a of resignation.
19. Así me acuesto, así me levanto, es un decir, porque no veo más que cuerpos gangrenosos, porque no veo más que buitres al acecho de un cadáver exquisito, y me parecen pajarillos indefensos, y les doy de comer de mi pierna, de la piel de mi pierna, del hueso de mi espalda.
We've been reading all over the country, and this is the first time that he has chosen this poem. 19. So I lie down, so I get up, a way of putting it, for I see nothing but gangrenous bodies, nothing but vultures waiting for an exquisite corpse. And they look like small defenseless birds to me, and I give them to eat from my leg, from the skin of my leg, from the bone of my back.
20. Cuando este reparto de zozobra se desate, habremos disipado la desdicha como un cáncer. Mi rostro será una mácula nauseabunda. Enormes lagartijas lamerán mi frente, mostrarán sus hocicos negros y se echarán a dormir una gloriosa siesta. Mientras tanto, el desierto abre sus fauces, sus dunas ardientes, se lleva mi jadeo y me retuerzo como un anfibio aletargado.
20. When this allotment of anxieties is released, we will have dissipated our misfortune like a cancer. My face will be a nauseating stain. Enormous lizards will lick my brow, exhibit their blackish snouts, and stretch themselves to sleep their glorious siesta. In the meantime, the desert opens its jaws, its burning dunes, and carries off my panting and my writhings like a lethargic amphibian. And what rough beast its hour come round at last slouches toward Bethlehem to be born. That's Yeats, not Santiago Vizcaíno.
That's at the end of the poem?
No.
You're just saying
it. I'm just saying it because this lethargic amphibian seems to me to come straight from Yeats's second coming.
La segunda venida.
It also reminded me of Pandora. It also reminded me of Pandora.
Pandora?
Well, the idea of dispersing these anxieties.
Yeah.
Es como abrir la caja de Pandora, sí. Y se desatan todos los males.
This poem, and we're a small group, we could actually talk about details. I mean, everybody, you guys are poets, and she's translated a book from the Canadien. That doesn't mean that it's French-Canadian, it means it's from
South Indian.
South India. I can tell you that I am dissatisfied with the first two lines in English. When this allotment of anxieties is released, we will have dissipated our misfortune like a cancer. Every word is correct.
Cuando este reparto de zozobra se desate, habremos disipado la desdicha como un cáncer.
Yeah, but here's the point. In Spanish, reparto, desate, disipado, desdicha are completely normal Spanish words. In English, allotment, anxieties, dissipated, misfortune are heavier than the average Anglo-Saxon word. English resides, its power resides in monosyllables, mostly. And in those first two lines, I got trapped into a kind of easy, there's an expression, the false cousin, the false cognate.
Yeah.
These aren't false cognates. These are worse. Because these are cognates that look as if they really are true. But they're not true to the spirit of the English language. What I should have done, I don't know. But when this allotment of anxieties is released, we will have dissipated our misfortune like a cancer. That line is so heavy with polysyllables that I'm almost grateful when I get to the cancer. Finally sounds like ordinary English. My face will be a nauseating stain.